and welcome back to Intro to Tech Skills. I'm so excited for this session. We have so many people. And wait, just before we go into it, I keep having to remind you that we have artificial intelligence gaming for you to check out when you have free time. You also have the Minecraft time machine where you can build your own place 100 years from now, and also the Cloud Skills Challenge. So check those out with the link in the chat. Hey, what do we have next, Gwen?
Yeah, so we're going to be checking out real life end-to-end solutions built with Microsoft Azure, Power Platform, and Microsoft 365. And I know we have a packed session, so I'm going to go ahead and welcome and hand off to Microsoft Cloud Developer Advocate, Aicha Bass.
Thanks, Gwen. Hi, Selma and Gwen. Thanks for having us today. As you said, we're super crowded, so we just want to jump into our session. Thanks, everyone, for joining our session. We are so excited to be here. We have a lot to talk about, but before we jump into it, let me introduce you my colleague, Dan, who is joining me for hosting this session. Hi, Dan. How are you?
Hey, Aicha. I'm doing great. I'm really excited to hear from all the folks we have in this session.
Yes, me too. As you know, we have a full pack agenda for everyone. We will start with overview of Microsoft Cloud Technologies. If you don't know what Microsoft Cloud Technologies yet never heard of before, we will just make a quick introduction about it. And then we have three amazing projects built by advocates, MEPs, and student ambassadors. They will just show you how they built their solutions and maybe spark some inspirations for your own next project too. So, let's get into it. The big question then, what is Microsoft Cloud? As you know, a lot of folks always think that the Microsoft Cloud is Microsoft Azure, but we actually have a lot more to offer for developers inside Microsoft Cloud. Do you want to just talk about it? What is Microsoft Cloud in general? Do you have any examples about it?
Yeah, I think you're right. I think most people hear Microsoft Cloud, they instantly think Azure, which is part of it, but there's a lot more to the story. So, for example, you might want to host an app in Azure that pulls in organizational data from Microsoft 365, for example, and then maybe even does that with something like Power Automate to automate a process. Or you might build an application using a low-code approach like Power Apps, and that may tie into Azure APIM or Azure API management. And really the list goes on. We could have Azure static web apps, which also can use GitHub, and we can use GitHub Actions to automatically publish our app and build it and do those types of things. So really the sky's the limit here. But Aicha, why don't you tell us a little bit more about why it's so important for these different technologies to work together?
Yeah, so it may sound a little complex because we talk about so many different technology names right now. There are a lot of technologies involved building applications, as you know, and we will need different technologies for each part of our application. And it might be challenging to integrate and secure all of them at the same time. Oftentimes it feels like having complex set of building blocks together without having a manual, so you don't know what to do with it. But actually, by using Microsoft Cloud, you can integrate these services that address the needs of your application, and all these technologies are designed to work together. So they click each other when you're building an application. It's like having that manual you were looking for at the beginning, and then building blocks start working together to achieve your goal in your organization. We have a great documentation about it. Dan actually lead a great project to have a white paper about Microsoft Cloud. Dan, would you like to tell us about white cloud? What can people find more in this documentation?
Sure. Really, the goal of the document, you'll see this at the aka.ms link at the bottom, Microsoft-Cloud-Solutions. And what this does is provides an overview. It's kind of geared towards IT leadership, to walk them through the different benefits that integrating the services across the Microsoft Cloud offers. So for example, in this diagram that you see here, you'll notice that we have an external app, an internal app, and then it ties into Azure and Microsoft 365, and even things like Dynamics 365. So if you're interested in getting more details about that, you can check out the link you see on your screen there.
Exactly. Since we talk about Microsoft Cloud in general, and we have the white paper as well for you to check out in the link, we also have three amazing projects live to share with you today. And we don't want to take too much of your time, but jump into the projects and learn how the experts, the technology experts, build these solutions. So I just want to jump into our first project and introduce Frank and Jason to talk about a project with Bud. Hi, Frank, Jason, feel free to take over.
Thank you, Aisha. So yes, so Jason and I are Cloud Advocate working in the same team. But today, the project we want to talk about is not a it's a team project, and it was all those great people that you see in the screen. So Ruth, Aisha was part of this, Christopher, Amy, Jason, and myself. And it was during a hackathon that we decided to create BitBot, the project we want to talk about. And not all of us were developer. So that's why we are very interested to use low code, no code technology. And, you know, not even all of us had experience building a chatbot. So having simple technology to make progress was very important for us. But Jason, why not you share who was our audience?
Yeah, thanks, Frank. And hi, everybody. Yeah, so as Frank mentioned, we had this hackathon project to put together a chatbot that was really intended to be a companion application to help a lot of our stakeholders and users for Learn TV. And those would be the folks that are working tirelessly to put on live events such as Build, but also shows that you might see like Ask the Expert and Hello World. So there's a lot of information that needs to be shared and tracked and all kinds of stuff when it comes to these shows and events. And our source of truth for a lot of that is Azure DevOps, as well as Kusto, or Azure DevOps Explorer is sort of the tool we use to access Kusto. So we've got information all over the place. And we need to be able to make sure that people can access that information, they can collaborate on that kind of stuff real easy. So that's what we aim to do, is try to find solutions for those folks and see if we can make their life a little bit better. Now, I'm going to show you a little bit about the architecture, some of the decisions we made. Frank and I are going to go into detail about that in just a moment. But before we do that, I thought, Frank, maybe you can go ahead and cue us up here. Let's take a look at what BitBot can do so you can see some of the actions in action, and then we can talk more about the details of how this thing was built.
BitBot is a companion tool for show owners, hosts, guests, and producers of content on Learn TV. In developer relations, Azure Boards is the source of truth for nearly everything related to shows and events. So, having easy and efficient access to important information is critical to our success. As our team and tooling scale up and more content is created and tracked within Azure Boards, teammates are beginning to have questions such as, when is my next show? When BitBot is asked this question, it provides users with information about upcoming live streams, recordings, or events. To keep a pulse on individual work streams, due dates, and deliverables, the bot can also assist in providing increased visibility into projects. By asking what is due, we can see a list of all work that are marked with a due date of today or older. This returns data from a specific query within Azure Boards that I can continue to modify if needed. Another great command is triage. This shows only a single action item, presumably the most urgent, based on due date and stack rank in the backlog. To make life easier for our team, general questions about organization data and analytics are included to point users to the right resources. Questions like, how do I access our Kusto data? Or where can I find common KQL queries? Will summon BitBot to point users to the official documentation and team resources. Show owners will be happy to see that requesting specific show data is as simple as typing show data. There, you can view the results of popular queries of specific shows. With so many moving pieces and handoffs between teammates, it's often tedious but critical to update the status of work items as in progress or done. To ease this process, the chatbot can help by updating the status of multiple work items at once. And if you're looking for documentation related to Learn TV, BitBot can help. Last, no chatbot is complete without a feedback mechanism. Simply typing feedback gives users an opportunity to connect with the team directly for further improvements. Thanks.
So as you can see in that demo, there's quite a few things that we set out to do for our users, and we wanted to make sure that the bot could manage those things. Now, as Frank mentioned earlier, we wanted to take sort of the low-code, no-code approach. This was done during a hackathon, and we knew that Teams was going to be our interface. So as you probably noticed in the demo, we've got Power Virtual Agents set up that actually communicate with Azure DevOps as well as Kusto or Azure Data Explorer to provide some of that information back to our users. Now, Frank's going to go into another demo to show you another piece of functionality, but Frank, you want to talk us through some of the other architectural decisions we made?
Yeah, so let me explain the proactive one. So that's the part of the schema that is top right of your screen right now. So most of the time when we interact with a chatbot, we as humans start the dialogue. But in this specific case, we wanted to have the bot to initiate the conversation based maybe on a schedule, looking into it. In our case, Azure DevOps running a query and based on the result, having a list of people and reaching them directly to ask them something. In the next demo, what I want to do is show you when we create those tasks in Azure DevOps, sometimes information are missing. I don't have your email. I don't have something. So that's what we're looking at. So proactive, but this is how we do it.
How to run a recurring task that notify our Azure DevOps user that some information are missing. So first, you go in Azure DevOps, create a query. Here I have one, and we can see it returns one result. Then you go to Power Automate and you will create a recurrence event. And here I'm using once a month, but you use whatever makes sense for you. And then we'll run that query. So just connecting to my organization, my project, specifying the query I need here. And this action, this Azure DevOps action, will return a list of IDs. So now I go for each one of them, I need to get the details. So I'm using another Azure DevOps action and I'm specifying the ID. From that, I will have all the information I need to make some validation, in my case, validating that some information are present or not. And then I will create an adaptive card from the Power Automate to send back to Teams. And I'm just connecting it here. And then I'm sending that schema that I felt. How to return this? I'm really glad you asked because it's a good information. So the trick is run your flow without that action, without the Power Post adaptive card. And then you go back here to the result and you have your history. So open one of the history, it will look like this, and you could scroll to get the work item details and look your output. Copy this and paste it into the adaptive card designer. So that's adaptivecard.io. You go there, you paste it here. And then from here, you will be able to drag and drop very simply and build whatever you want. When you have the result you like, you copy that and paste it back to your adaptive card. And this is how you get a very nice looking adaptive card that notify you that some information are missing inside Teams.
And voila, I hope you get inspired to build your own chatbot. We put all the link, all the information in this short URL. It's just a recipe, so do whatever you want. But now Jason and I will be joining the chat to answer your question and looking forward to see you at the Q&A to answer more questions. And now back to you, Aisha and Dan.
Thanks, Jason and Frank. That was an amazing presentation. And this bot is a really good example of showing how we can automate the processes internally. Then definitely we need more of those bots for our team processes too.
Absolutely. There's so many scenarios where it's like, oh, I forgot to do that or forgot to fill this in. And I love the proactive nature of that.
Definitely, I agree.
Well, from here, let's go ahead and jump on in, Aisha, because we still have two other teams that we want to go into. And exactly. We're going to talk about the community bot for OneDrive. So this is also a very exciting presentation. I think everybody's going to really enjoy it. So let me introduce Thomas, Stefan, and Hans, and take it away, folks.
So I have to say, yes, we are doing this community project. It's not a building project. We do it in our free time. And you see there are three MVPs out of two countries here in in Europe. So me in Germany and Thomas and Stefan are in Austria. And this is an AI MVP and there's also a developer MVP. And that means they give it the information that you have to do what you can do. They came to me in the early days and say, okay, we want to digitize you. Digitize me? So we talk about in 2019, it's ongoing project still there. And this is very interesting in Vienna, and in 2 months or 5 months later, we have it in Germany at the SharePoint Saturday at Microsoft department. And then they say, we have a mock-up for you. So we have the first pictures, we have a project name, Mr. OneDrive Spot. Microsoft give me this name because they had to do it. So then we are starting with all with the Q&A maker, building a German database, but we see it's not the best way to translate from German to the other languages. So we make a second one, building an English database. Then we have a first release, it takes with 100 people around the globe and other MVPs. What is going on? That first release to submit was in 2020. And we have a little discussion with Microsoft, with legal, with brand, but that was in the past. Then we have to decide with the help of the vice president of OneDrive, the new name. They said, okay, we must do it a little bit, community board for OneDrive. Again, discussion, then we have the release. And then we see, hey, not all people can do that. The bot will run in Teams. So therefore, sometimes the enterprise people cannot look at it. So therefore, we make also with the same bot in the background, with the same database, we do a web chat version. And now we do it also a quality dashboard. And we will show you what we have there.
And before we actually take a look at what the community bot for OneDrive really looks like in action, I'd like to give you an idea of how it works behind the curtains, right? So as Hans mentioned, the community bot for OneDrive sits primarily in Teams, although there's a web chat version as well. And therefore, the users who have installed the community bot for OneDrive in Teams, they may ask a question through Teams. And what Teams does basically is picking up that question and routing it to the bot framework infrastructure, as our bot is hosted within Azure. The Azure bot framework and Azure bot service is picking that up and then forwarding that question, as you can see in number three, to our bot logic. Our bot is deployed as an Azure web app, so the bot logic picks that up, it retrieves the question, and then it decides basically what is the language of the input, what is the language of that specific question, because we learned the knowledge base and the information which is provided to the bot is only available in English language, but the users could also be speaking other languages like German, French, Spanish, or whatever. So if the language of the user and if the question language is not English, we will be asking the translator service in Azure, to translate the question into English before going to the Q&A make knowledge base and retrieving the most appropriate answer for that specific question. And then if the answer has been given back to the bot basically decides again if the answer needs to be translated as well, because we don't want to answer a question in English which has been marked in any other language. So if, for instance, the question has been present in German, we'll make sure that the answer is also be given to the user in German language before going the same way back through the Azure bot service and through Teams back to the user to give the most appropriate answer. And with that, I'd say we'll take a look at what the community bot for OneDrive really looks like.
Thanks, Stephan and Hans. So it's now my turn and the demo time. We prepared a little video here where you can see the bot actually in the Teams client. And of course, we start with a nice greeting, saying hi to our bot because we are nice people, and then immediately fire away with the first question. I'm always looking for how to share documents. That's why this phrase is always present there. Getting back the answers, and immediately I see a follow-up prompt. So the bot already shows content that is related to my question. Another very important topic, of course, is security. So let's search for Fort Knox over here. Then you see we also integrate pictures in our bot and a nice way of formatting. As Hans mentioned, not all of enterprises are, in the terms of governance, allowing people to install applications to their Teams environments. In that case, we also have a web chat version of the same bot. So again, we greeted our bot here and we can again use the interface to ask for sharing. Also in the web interface, we have a nice representation. We have the same quality of image, the same quality of content, and of course, also our follow-up prompt. So clicking on shared with me, gives me more information about that kind. And of course, we have link content to Microsoft documentation or to Hans' blog. But of course, there's one more thing, right? Our quality dashboard. So refreshing the quality dashboard, and then you see in the question column all the questions in our demo so far. So we are tracking what users are actually asking our bot, and we are separating those regarding their channels, meaning web chat or Teams, so that we know and get a feeling which is actually used out there. And most importantly, of course, we are looking for the different scoring of our answers. So this is basically the result we get back from our Q&A maker. And yeah, for Stefan and for me, that's a really, really great part of the project, because if we need attention over here, that means that Hans needs to work some more hours. We hope you're now inspired, and please, please, please stay with the build conference, stay with your agenda. Use our resources afterwards to build your own version of your bots or your own ideas. But Hans, there's quite a tech cloud over here. What's up with that?
That's all the things we have in OneDrive. OneDrive is not only a small thing. And you see four NUGs, that's a little thing in the upper corner left. And you see so many different names about that the bot needs all, and he knows about that. And that is okay when we use it. But we have to say, I have to sleep. And that is a different one. If I sleep, I cannot answer it. The bot never sleeps. And that means you can ask the bot 24 hours for OneDrive questions. And that means introducing and have say, okay, they have digitized me. Back to Asia.
Wow, that was an amazing presentation. Thank you so much, Stephan, Hans, and Thomas. This is the first time I'm hearing something like digitizing a person. Dan, what do you think about this? It's really genius, right?
It's great, because there's a lot of teams I've worked with over the years that they have a ton of knowledge, but they just don't have the bandwidth to constantly be sharing that. Like Hans said, you have to sleep at some point. So I think it's a great concept that people can take into consideration if they'd like to, you know, share that knowledge more throughout the enterprise.
We should definitely digitize some of our colleagues, because we are in different part of the world. So we should definitely try that out. So up next, we have another amazing session. We actually have student ambassadors with us, Somalis and Anj. Somalis just became cloud advocate as well, which is very inspiring. They built a bot for onboarding scenarios for the communities, which is also another helpful scenario. So hi, Somalis, Anj, feel free to take over.
Thank you so much, Aisha, for having us. Now I would like to share a solution, which is onboarding bot for communities. This has been built by Somalis Idiko, who is a cloud advocate at Microsoft, and myself, Anj. I am a Microsoft Learn student ambassador. Now I would like to quickly introduce you to our team. So our team comprises of a diverse group of individuals, and the team members are Aditya Garg, Somalis Idiko, Hemantika Mitra, and me, Anj Mishra. Now I would like to quickly walk you through the building blocks of the bot. So basically, we have used Microsoft Teams as a user interface where the user can interact with Microsoft Teams in a designated channel. Now, the user has to mention the bot. After the user has mentioned the bot, it triggers a Power Automate flow, which posts an adaptive card on Teams to enable the user to ask the question to the bot. Now, when the user asks the question to the bot, it basically queries the Q&A maker.ai knowledge base, and it does it through Q&A Maker and Azure Bot Services to fetch the question and answer pairs. After the question and answer pairs have been fetched, the Power Automate flow gets triggered and posts the answer back on Teams and also mentions the user to make sure that the query of the user has been resolved. So the problems that we are solving with this project is a bot to support the community. The bot will be available 24/7 to make sure that any doubt that you have is being solved. And also the other problem that we have solved with this project is easy addition of Q&A pairs to the knowledge base. Now my friend Diego will walk you through the project demo.
So let's jump right
into how the bot actually works. As mentioned, the bot exists in a designated Teams channel where the users of a specific community can be able to ask questions. So for them to do that, they can click on new conversation and add mention the bot itself, where once the ad mentioned the bot, it will then kick off a Power Automate flow in the background, which will then post back to the user an adaptive card where the user can be able to paste their question or post their question. For an example, a question about a specific program or a specific community, and then they can submit their question. Once the user submits their question, what happens is that the Power Automate flow goes back to the knowledge base and queries it for that specific question, and then brings back the answer once it finds it, and mentions the user, because a community will always be busy and it will be hard for the user to be able to see where their answer is if it's a busy community. So it's better to have the bot at mentioning the user back and providing that specific answer to the question. Then the bot proceeds to send a direct message to the user. So that direct message to the user is in the form of a card where the user can specify if the bot answered the question or the bot answered the question. So the user can then choose yes or no. So in this case, we can choose yes and add comments if you want to, and then submit. Then that will terminate the bot. But if the user had selected no in this case, it will then post another adaptive card to the user to ask them to put their question on an adaptive card, and then once they click on submit, that question would then be sent to the admin, where the admin needs to update the knowledge base with that new question. Thank you so much. So you saw how the bot actually works. We walked you through the demo, and Ansh actually gave you a very great background scenario. So you're wondering, what's next? What is the next step to take as a person who's just seen this cool project? So for me and Ansh and the rest of the team, we'd like to actually urge you to jump right over and be inspired, learn more using these resources that we actually have on the slides. For an example, if you want to learn more about the bot and you actually want the working bot on your PC, you can use the aka.ms PP sample so that you can be able to use the bot and you can build on top of it. And then obviously I would like to urge you guys, if you're students out there, to actually join the Microsoft Learn Student Ambassadors program, because that is where Ansh and I actually collaborated, came together and built this wonderful project. So obviously our call to actions is to learn, learn, and learn. Obviously I want to take this back to Aisha. So back to you, Aisha.
Thank you so much, Samalaje. Ansh, it was a great session. Thanks for sharing this great solution with us. And as Samalaje mentioned, we have great other projects in the ambassador program. Students come together and build really great solutions together. And this one is really inspiring, especially they build something for the community, their own student community. And they now use it in the community. And you can build one inspiring solution for your own community, or you can become a part of ambassador program. And you can get to meet with people, great ideas, and you can build something all together. So before we move forward to questions and answers, I already took some notes about questions. We just want to go through the resources. Dan, would you like to just walk us through what do we have available for Microsoft Cloud?
Sure. So first off, if you'd just like some overall learning resources, you can go to the AKAMS, and then you'll see Microsoft Cloud Learning Resources. Just make sure to put that dash in there between them. And this is going to have all kinds of resources, actually, you can get to, from documentation to Microsoft Learn modules and more. Then we also mentioned at the beginning of this session, it's a brand new set of documents that were created for walking through the key benefits of tying these services together, just like everyone talked about throughout this session. and taking advantage of these building blocks that the overall Microsoft Cloud provides us. So you can go into that Microsoft Cloud Solutions link, and that'll have lots of details there about how you can get started. Now, you can also find a lot of resources in the Intro to Tech Skills GitHub repository. So you'll see a link there at the bottom. And I want to mention one more thing that Aicha and I also participated in that's not shown here, but it's in the same area as the Microsoft Cloud Solutions. And that is, you'll find some Microsoft Cloud scenarios available. And so, for example, Aicha, you know, we worked on some real-time collaboration, real-time presence, right? And that was pretty fun stuff.
Exactly. That was a great project. And we will probably have a lot more coming in the upcoming months.
Absolutely. And there's an on-demand session if you're interested in that, by the way, that Aicha and I did. So with that, Aicha, why don't I go ahead and turn it back to you? Because I know we'll have some Q&A here at the end and want to make time for that.
Thank you. And before we jump into the Q&A, I just want to mention that I know over the presentation during the projects, we shared a lot of links, but don't forget that all of the links we mentioned in this session will be available in akit.ms/intro-to-tech-skills-build. And you can just find all the resources available in that link. So don't worry about it. Everything is available for you in one single link. All right, so I already took some question notes and I want to ask to the projects specifically. The first question is to Bitbot. So Jason, Frank, if you're available, I just want to ask you, what are the things or services you can connect to with Bitbot?
Yeah, I can take that question. That's a fantastic one, Aicha. And honestly, this is the place I always point people to, my answer to this. If you go to aka.ms/bitbot, you'll get to all the links that we shared in our segment. But the most important one to answer this question, I think, is the list of all the Power Automate connectors. I don't know how many of them there are, but there are a ton of them. And this is your place to go and just browse everything that's available. Take a mental inventory of all the different tools and services that you use on a day-to-day basis. I showed that we were using Azure DevOps. We were also able to query into our Kusto, our Data Explorer data. Those are just a couple of the connectors, and it's not just Microsoft stuff too. I mean, it's services that are out there, third party, all kinds of things I've never even heard of. So go to aka.ms/bitbot, click on the link that takes you to the Power Automate connectors. There you'll see pretty much just an idea list of all the things that you could go build and go have fun. I mean, it's all really easy to get started, and hopefully you get some ideas out of that.
Awesome. Thank you so much. Great answer. And I also want to ask another question to community bot for OneDrive. Hans, Stephan, or Thomas, can any of you answer? You show us in the demo that there is a Teams version, but there's also a web chat version. Are those two different bots, or it's just one bot, and how did you do it?
Actually, that's a good question, and the short answer is no. More advanced answer is basically it's the same bot, and it's kind of shared across all the channels, and that's possible by using the Microsoft Bot Framework and the Azure Bot Service, because that platform lets us build the bot once and then roll it out to whatever channel you'd like. So for instance, you could have a bot running in Teams and at the same time maybe also in Facebook Messenger. And they share the same bot logic, they share the same code base. Obviously, you need to tweak it a little bit because Teams obviously offers things like adaptive cards and task modules or even messaging extensions, which are not present in any other channel. So you need to take that into consideration. But in general, you could say you start building your bot once, and then you can basically hit whatever channel you'd like or target those channels where the users are actually, because it doesn't make any sense if you as an organization have not rolled out Teams yet, but you're building a bot for Teams. Maybe instead building a bot as a web chat and place it into some sort of intranet scenario if that's available, or any other web chat scenario, which is easier to approach rather than, yeah, first off needing to introduce the whole platform like in Teams. But yeah, the short answer is you can build it once and then have it run wherever you'd like, or not wherever you'd like, but at least on whatever channel which is supported by the Azure Bot Service. And that's a lot.
Amazing. I'm glad that you mentioned this because, as you mentioned, in the Azure Bot Channel registration, we have many different options, not just web chat or Teams, but you can actually publish your bot in different channels as well. And Stefan and the team build one bot, but they're running the bot in different areas for the maybe different audience, which is really great. And one last question, it's to Somales and Ansh. How do you update the question and answer pairs in the knowledge base? Are they static or dynamic?
Well, good question, Aisha. A short version of that answer would be they're actually dynamic. How do we actually go about doing this? Is that through, even with the demo that we showed you and we mentioned in the demo, is that whenever a user is using the bot and they actually gotten that question, that did that answer the user's question or not, when they choose no, they have the option where the bot presents an adaptive card to them so that they can be able to paste in or type in that question that wasn't answered. And then that question is sent back to the administrators to actually either approve or disapprove of that question so that they can be able to update the knowledge base. So it's little less time or less effort from the admin to actually just be coming up with questions on their own, but they're taking those questions from the users because that's what the users want to know. And that's what they actually want the bot to be able to answer.
That's awesome. So we collect the questions from the community as well. That's great. So we make sure that admin approves if it is proper, then bot will be able to answer the questions asked by the community. That's a great feature. So with all these answers, I hope you like our session. This is all from us about the Microsoft Cloud and the community solutions. And I hope you enjoy our session. Have fun in the rest of the build. And I'm just giving back to Gwen and Salman. Thanks, everyone, for watching. Bye.